the second speaker of this session, Jeroen Koomen. Jeroen Koomen is a pharmacist by training, graduating from Utrecht University. Then afterwards did a PhD in clinical pharmacology in the diabetes therapeutic area in Groningen University. And since 2 years, Jeroen joined our group as a postdoc. Besides that, Jeroen is a clinical pharmacokinetics assessor at the Dutch Medicines Evaluation Board, which is the Dutch FDA. And he's a member of the European Medicines Agency Modeling and Simulation Working Party. Jeroen is going to present some of the work that he has been doing in our department in methodological approaches for handling ordered categorical data. Jeroen, the floor is yours.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to speak here today. It's a great pleasure. And indeed, as Peter already mentioned, I also work at the regulatory agency, so I guess that's my disclosure. So I don't think I'll have to introduce this part, but I'll go briefly over it. So this presentation is focused on the MOAA skill, but it extends to other categorical outcome skills. So next slide. Yeah, so the MOAA skill, or at least the OA skill, was originally developed by Chernik et al. Because they needed a way to evaluate the ability of the GABA-A antagonist flumazenil to reverse sedation induced by benzodiazepines. Next. Okay, I'm gonna ask you a lot of times to proceed. So this is what the original skill looked like. So basically there's four categories, and the composite score is basically the lowest score that was scored in any of these categories, or the sum of all the categories. So next. But nowadays we only tend to focus on the responsiveness aspect of this skill. Next slide. And it's important to note that this skill is not standardized. So the number of scores, they can either be reduced or they can be increased to characterize different depths of sedation. So next slide. And what is interesting to me at least is that this sort of gets an ordered nature into the data. So there's a few characteristics out there. For example, there's a finite number of skills. So that obviously doesn't tell or tells us that it's non-continuous. There's an order or ranking in the skills. I think one of the most important things is that the distances between skills are not equal. So that means that a patient moving from 4 to 2 cannot be considered a doubling in sedation, or equal to a patient moving from 3 to 1. Next slide. And I took an example of the DexMed European Public Assessment Report, because these types of data are sometimes handled as continuous data, and it has some disadvantages. So next. So for example, the models here suggest, so if you're gonna use this model for predictions, the model suggests categories that are not observed or not scored at very low concentrations, or the other side, very negative MOAA observations at very high concentrations. Next. Also, what to do if your model predicts at a concentration right in between these two, between two different categories. Basically, this violates that property of non-equal distances in the skill. And then next. And most of importantly, the model that is being used, that assumes a normal distribution of the residuals, basically. And that holds reasonably well at the middle part of the MOAA skill. But if you go to the extremes, that can also lead into, unequal prediction. So basically there's no homogeneous variance around that line. Next. So instead, what we can do is model the probability instead of model the actual skill itself. And there's a lot of approaches that have been described in literature. For example, you have a multinomial logistic regression model, the proportional odds model, the adjacent categories model, a different differential odds model, discrete time Markov models, and also continuous time Markov models. So there's a lot of data out there. Next. So I'll try to briefly walk you through all of these different models. And if we think about probabilities, then we usually think of it as the ratio of the event of interest divided by the total number of events, or the odds divided by the total odds. And that's sort of inclines that the scale is limited. So you can only have a probability between 0 and 100%. And this can be enforced by the XBIT transformation or the inverse logic transformation. And that's sort of shown on the top right. So that maps, basically a variable to this 0 to 100% scale. And the reverse can be achieved by the logit transform, which is shown on the bottom right of the screen. And there you can see that, basically you can map the probability back to the infinite scale. Next slide. One back. This is basically the great thing about a logistic regression model, because that takes this into account. It basically, if you look at, I've mentioned the equations, but I'll try to explain it all graphically. But if you look at it, then you can see that basically the odds, which is above the line, is divided by the total odds. You can basically model the probability of each individual scale. If you increase the intercept, this is referred to as a theta zero, you can see that the entire curve shifts to the right, or if you decrease it, it shifts to the left. Next slide. If you increase or decrease the slope, you can see that the steepness shifts in the curve. That tells you something about how is the relationship between your predictor variable and the probability of an event. Next slide. And the nice thing is that the inverse of this a model is basically the probability of the other event that you're interested in. So in this case, it's just a binomial. And this was basically the idea behind the multinomial logistic regression model, because if you extend this model for multiple categories, you get this multinomial logistic regression model. Next slide. And here you can see an example. So basically, instead of only having the odds of one category in the bottom, you get the total odds of all the different categories. And then you can model the probabilities of each and every score. But this model has a drawback, and that's that the ordering is neglected, because every category has its own predictor function, basically. So here you can see that, for example, as a limitation of the data, the model could predict that you're observing a MOAS of one before observing a MOAS of two, or at least the model will predict that the probability is higher, which is a bit strange. So we can maintain the ranking in this multinomial logistic regression model with the proportional odds model. And basically, we'll use that intercept value to enforce the order between the different categories. So you can either say that the first intercept is, for example, higher than the next intercept, et cetera, and then enforce an order. Another assumption that has been made in this model is that the shape of this curve then has to be similar, because otherwise the curves can still cross and you still get predictions about that violates the orderer property. And what is important to note is that instead of modeling individual probabilities of the different scales, we're modeling cumulative probabilities, but we're usually only interested in the individual probability. If you go to the next slide, that's basically only subtraction. And then if you do press the next, you can see that for that same type of data, you can see that the order is now maintained. There's other types of models also out there. You have the adjacent categories model. I won't go into the details, but what is important to note is that it's not predicting the cumulative probability, but it basically compares the probability to the next lower category. And then you also have the differential odds model, which is basically the same as the proportional odds model, but then you enforce your predictor function to be higher or lower than the next or lower category. So that gives a bit more flexibility to the model. Next. And then I think the previous speaker already sort of introduced this topic. We can also consider each of the individual MOAS categories as states and then model the transition probabilities between each of these states. I've given an example here where you can, each of these arrows, there's arrows between all the different categories, but I've, for the, to make it clear, I've only shown categories leaving the fifth MOAS scale. So if you previously observed the MOAS category of 5, you can now model the probability of each of the individual next scales, basically. Next. And the interesting thing is that you can do this for all the previous model structures that I've just introduced. So you can extend the multinomial logistic regression model, you can extend the proportional odds model, you can extend the adjacent categories model, and even the differential odds model. You can all extend them to have this sort of Markov element in them. And here I've given a definition of the proportional odds model. Next slide. The drawback of this discrete time Markov models is that they basically assume discrete time, and we can, it's very hard to collect discrete data or discrete time data in clinical practice. So we can expand these models to also represent continuous time. And instead of then modeling the transition probability, we're modeling basically the transition rates between the different states. Next slide. So I'll try to sort of demonstrate what could be achieved with an example of Remy Mazalam. And in this study, we basically evaluated which of these modeling approaches is now most suitable to adequately describe the data. And we try to emphasize on the clinical implications between the different approaches that were described. So mainly the differences in the exposure response relationship that can be extracted from each of these different model structures. So for this, we had 4 data sets available with quite densely sampled data, and the number of observations here represents the MOAS data. And next slide. So step one, we used a previously published pharmacokinetic model, basically so that the pharmacokinetics were adequately or like equally described between the different model structures. Next slide. We fixed the model predictions using the individual parameters. So we developed these models using a sequential approach. So we estimated model parameters using maximum likelihood estimation, but of course you can also pursue a Bayesian approach. For me, I used a NOMEM with the Laplacian algorithm to estimate all the different parameters. I tried to evaluate different drug effects, so linear, Emax, or sigmoid type of relationships. And I also evaluated whether we could estimate this effect compartment for each of these models. I explored variability, and the way I evaluate the models is basically to assess it numerically with an objective function value, which is basically a number that tells you how good is the overall fit of the model. But I also conducted simulations to see whether trends in the data were adequately described. And basically, I looked at the proportion of observations versus the concentration and time, but also these different transitions. Next slide. Next. So first, so this is an overview slide of the results. So if you compare these time-independent models, you can see that the proportional odds model and the adjacent categories model, they basically perform better than the model where the ordering is neglected. And that can be observed in terms of this objective function value. You can also see that there's less parameters compared to the multinomial logistic regression model. And here we could also estimate Emax relationships instead of the linear relationship that was apparent for the multinomial logistic regression model. So then if we extend the models, each of these models with this Markov element, you can see that the overall fit of the models greatly improves. So you can see reductions of around 700 to 900 points, but this comes at the cost of a lot of more additional parameters, because we now have to model each of the transition probabilities. And you can see that's also reflected in some of the parameter estimates with quite high relative standard errors. And then if you move to the next, So there's two types of continuous time Markov models. I won't go into the details, but what you can see is with the Markov model, we approach that discrete time Markov model, goodness of fit, but there's a lot less parameters. So instead of the 30 plus parameters that were needed to describe each of the transitions, you can see that if you move to continuous time, you lose a little bit of your overall model fit, but you can see there's a lot less parameters, and therefore that model is probably the preferred approach. Next slide. So what we then did is we looked at the model simulations, to compare each of these different categories, we looked at for MOAS 5 and for MOAS 0, we looked at the half maximum probability of reaching that score, what was the typical concentration? And for MOAS 4 to 0, we looked at, or 4 to 1, we looked at when is the maximum probability being predicted by the model and what is then the concentration. If you go to the next slide. So here you can see sort of an overview of what are the typical predictions for each of these different MOAS scales. And what you can see is that for MOAS 5 and 4 and 3, you can see that there's not a lot of differences. But if you move to more a higher depth sedation, you can see that the difference between the model structures can be quite pronounced in predicting where is the maximum or half maximum probability. Next slide. So those simulations were all conducted in steady state, basically factoring out the difference or the influence of time. But here I've simulated a bolus infusion, so basically 5 milligrams over 1 minute, and I sort of showed what is the probability of achieving a MOAS score of 2 or 3, and comparing the proportional odds that doesn't account for that time dependency, and the continuous time Markov model. And you can see that the dynamic behavior can be quite different also between the different model structures. And if you look at the individual, skills, you can see that, especially in this case, in the higher MOAS observation rates, the dynamic behavior can be quite different, which could have clinical consequences. So, next slide. So sort of to wrap up, if you choose to use these categorical models, they need fixes when there's an absence of a specific category. So if you're missing observations in a category, you cannot model it. And then that needs fixes into the model. And this is especially relevant to the discrete time Markov model, because we're modeling a lot of transitions between different states. So if you did not observe a given transition, you would need to make assumptions on how it behaves. What I also found is that if you preserve the order in the model structure, that results in, at least for Ramazalam, in a better overall fit of the model. Like I already sort of hinted towards, is that the discrete time Markov models, they assume discrete time intervals. So these are probably only suitable to simulate an exactly similar trial with a similar type of behavior. But they're probably less suitable for extrapolations to different trial or different populations or different clinical trial designs. And in that case, it would be better to use continuous time Markov models, but this comes at the cost of increased computation time. So the continuous time Markov models, they take around 2 hours to estimate, whereas the other models are in the neighborhood of 5 to 10 minutes. So that's a big difference. And what is also interesting, and I think I did not really highlight that during the results table, but the effect compartments can only be estimated in basically the time independent and the discrete time Markov models. But if we use continuous time Markov models, basically that model structure is flexible enough to already incorporate the delay between PK and PD, because you model the drug effect directly on a rate constant. So in that case, it's very difficult to use an effect size TCI, for example. Next slide. So what I want to sort of highlight in this presentation is that the choice of the model really, or the choice of the model structure really could have an influence on your exposure response relationships, and therefore maybe also those. And this is especially relevant for the lower MOAS categories. And what you could also see is that the dynamic behavior could change quite a lot in non-steady state between the different model structures. So that could also have an influence on when you collect new samples, for example. This one could be a limitation of the study design, but at least in this data set, it looked like we could not sort of estimate the effect compartment, and therefore that changes the need for the effect compartment. To further see whether I can harmonize these different findings, we have now data available for other compounds as well, and I'm gonna just repeat the analysis and see whether there's harmonization possible. So thank you very much.
Any questions from the audience?